I was in the background music business in 1958, and we used a subchannel. That was the key to my background music presentation to people. And it became evident then that we needed an FM station ourselves, and I was an old radio guy, and so we went ahead and put together a radio station. I did it with Gordon Swan, a really great engineer and a nice guy who worked with me at WSB Television. And I called an old college friend of mine to come down and be sales manager. His name was Latham. And you get a pattern there, K for Kennedy, L for Latham, and S for Swan. And so we put together the radio station on a mountaintop in Marietta, Blackjack Mountain, and on Barnes Mill Road. And we built a shack and a studio in the shack and a 320-foot tower and started with 6,350 watts. We picked 96.1 because at the time, the two key FM stations, and there weren't many of them, the two key FM stations were WGKA, down 93 or something, and WSB FM, which was 98.5, as it still is. So we picked a place in between so people would find us tuning back and forth. And that was the idea. We did easy listening music.
Easy listening, familiar music, WKLS.
This is the actual first microphone that we ever used on KLS. When we signed on at 1 o'clock on December 2nd, 1960, this was the microphone. September of 70 is when we sold it to SJR Communications.
We had done other work for SJR Communications successfully, I'm glad to say. And we had to fight, however, to get WKLS. They did not want to give that to us, and we knew that if we got that station, that we had a clear shot at having very big 18 to 34 ratings. After 6 months of pitching, I'll use that word, pitching, they finally agreed that we could take it over. And the first problem we had was, what are we going to call the station? There was great debate in our company, our consulting company, whether it should be 96 Rock or Rock 96. We sat on that for 2 or 3 days, and finally it came out to be 96 Rock.
It was a Friday afternoon, of course, and I went back in my office, and the phone rang. On the other end of the phone was Kent Burkhart. He said, what happened? And I said, well, I was just zapped. And he said, yeah, I know, don't worry about a thing. He says, I'm going to be working with WKLS, and I want you to be the morning man. I said, I'm not even a disc jockey. And he says, You'll kill him. He says you'll be great. Don't worry about it.
So Barry Chase and Drew Murray and I, we pulled an all-nighter, turned it off at midnight. I think Drew actually worked the last shift of the old format too, if I remember correctly.
Signed it off Sunday night at midnight, spent 5 hours, you know, taking all the old beautiful music records out and putting all the rock records into the library. And they were supposed to sign on at 6 o'clock in the morning, but they were done at 5. So they went, go ahead, sign it on. So I signed it on at 5 a.m. July 15th, 1974.
And I always heard it started out with guys wearing jackets and that you could go and look at them over by the Omni somewhere and look through the glass when they broadcast. And all these legendary stories. The first song I ever played on 96 Rock was a trivia question, Bob O'Reilly by The Who.
That was me, and it was a last minute decision. I mean, I went through, I thought about a bunch of good morning songs like Good Morning by the Beatles, but just, I don't know, just going through the library and looking through it, just it's only Teenage Wasteland seemed appropriate, so that was the first song.
The control room was actually on the second floor of the Atlanta Townhouse Hotel.
Kind of a dump, a strange location for a rock and roll station.
When Ringling Brothers came to town, when the Wrestlers came to town, this is where they stayed. The elevator doors once opened up, and in the back was Andre the Giant and his teeny little girlfriend.
It had a pretty bizarre staff. There was a guy on at night who had a duck. So he'd be, you know, that's the Allman Brothers, and then, you know, just a little duck sidekick.
But I remember there were a lot of bad phone calls, people freaking out because it had been a beautiful music station for all those years, you know, from when it signed on the air in the 60s. And people that had gone to bed on Sunday night turned their radio off and turned it on Monday morning and heard this loud, raucous rock and roll, and they weren't happy.
There was a program director at the time, nice guy, but very top 40, who took a lot of convincing that you can't play Olivia Newton-John next to the Allman Brothers.
Station was dominant to number one, 18 to 34 men, and not so bad in 18 to 34 women. And the advertisers climbed all over it.
There, I just remember clearly, there were nights when a bunch of staff members would come down, would all sit at typewriters and type up promos and type cards, and you know, somebody would put a Marshall Tucker song on, hey, we should play this. Yeah, let's play this. It was just really a magical creative experience. Nobody realized at the time that we were making history.
I always thought this radio station from day one had something mystical about it. It was magic. And it sounded good in the first minute.
It was the sound of not only the Southeast, but you know, the whole country. I remember back then, guys would come into town from, you know, Seattle or Minneapolis, whatever, with their tape recorders to tape 96 Rock.
I talked to a guy that was up in Greenville, South Carolina at the time, and they had like a special antenna at the station pointed at Atlanta just so they could pick up 96 Rock and take the good ideas from them. They openly admitted to that.
I guess the biggest promotion we had, because in the beginning we had no promotion money, was saving the Fox Theater. Dean Clark, who followed me on the air, came on the air at 10 o'clock. They moved a motorhome up to the roof of the Atlanta townhouse, so everybody passing by on the expressway at 10th Street would look up on the roof and they'd see the trailer with the big banner on it that said 96 Rock, Save the Fox. Dean lived up in the trailer for, I don't know how long it was, at least a couple of months.
You think about Rocky Raccoon, you think about, oh, bless her heart, Allison, who is Rocky, but you'd see Rocky at every single concert. It didn't matter what radio station you listened to. You're looking down, and there you could see in the front row walking around and messing with people is Rocky Raccoon with a big 96 Rock on him. And 96 Rock was part of everybody's life that grew up in Atlanta at that time.
I think probably one of the things that made 96 Rock work is that it was a party station on the air, but the people that worked there actually partied together.
I mean, really, it's only rock and roll, and it's only radio. I mean, it's not like we're doing brain surgery here. It's supposed to be fun. And we really knew how to have a good time.
I started listening to 96 Rock, I guess probably about the eighth, ninth grade. And I was like, you know, this is a cool rock station. I noticed all the seniors and juniors had the 96 Rock tag, and they all had it upside down, because I guess the big thing was, you know, turn up 96 Rock.
No MTV, there were no Ticketmaster, no internet, no downloads. I mean, it was just, you know, you and the records that were on the turntable. You were out there for the whole world to see, and it actually meant something, and you had fun.
Hi, I'm from Georgia. How we all talk like Luke Duke and all the Dukes of Hazzard. Hey, how you doing? Hello, 96 Rock.
Must be Elvis. This is hot, this is happening, and this is what the people want to hear.
I did my thing at 96 Rock for 6 years. Six long, confusing, erratic, sometimes erotic years, doing sports commentaries on the Mark and Steve Morning Show. I'll never forget. I had finished my night shift at CNN and dropped by the station after midnight to record my commentary, and was met at the front door by a blonde in see-through lingerie. It's not important now who that was. Needless to say, it was a lot more fun working at The Rock than at CNN.
Yeah, we had a job to do, but there wasn't anything said we couldn't have fun while we were doing it. Although I think that culture was in place at 96 Rock when I got there. It's not something I had to install.
They were the two. Dick first, then Tom, and between the two, they ran a great operation. Do your job, do it well, have a good time at it, and we'll reward you for it.
Apparently there had been a complaint. Dick calls me into his office, and he says, did you tell some kind of joke yesterday? And I said, you know, I think I probably did. And he said, well, how did it go? I said, well, I felt good about it. My delivery seemed to be right on the money. The timing was, he said, no, I mean, tell me the joke. I said, oh. I said, so What did the elephant say to the nude man? How do you breathe through that little thing? Well, he sat there and he was just, he was turning blue. I thought the man was going to pass out. And finally, when he regained his composure, he said, "We don't need that kind of blue humor on our radio station." I said, "Yes, sir." I said, "You can go ahead and laugh now."
I have been in his office and seen things blow up out in the hallway, and Dick, in his cool, professional way, would either let it play out or go in and join it at some point. But he really did know how to let creative people have their head.
And for that, I will forever be grateful. And Dick, wherever you are, well, I know exactly where you are. God bless you.
96 Rock, as we all know and love it, lasted 32 years. Dick and I, between the two of us, managed 24 of those. Two of us had our mark on it.
We had a good time, and our two general managers led us through all that.
So the 70s, it was something just really cool. The 80s, I think it was on fire. You never knew what you were going to hear next. They were constantly breaking songs, alternative and rock. And I think that was 96 Rock's finest moment, at least for me. The 90s...
They felt we needed to do things a little differently. They told us how they were doing it in Cincinnati.
A lot of radio stations, somewhere along the line, lose their soul. They learned the lesson very quickly that there was a unique concept in the South and in Atlanta.
But I know that once that happens, and you lose your real foothold or foundation in the market, things will go away.
It's weird the effect 96 Rock at least has had on Atlanta. I mean, I grew up in Atlanta. I listened to it. 96 Rock was bigger than life, the logo. And now I really feel like we're all kind of a copy off of 96 Rock. You know, the heritage rock station, the feel, the stunts, the edginess. And it just kills me that 96 Rock's not around any longer.
96 Rock, I don't think there's an end to it. Whether it's on the air or not, 96 Rock lives in a lot of people's hearts.
Atlanta is the most wonderful rock and roll community in the nation.